All right, we're here to rock and roll all night and party every day. Big T's hair, concert t-shirts, spandex, and groupies. Hell yeah. The 80s had kick-ass rock music, and we're cranking it all the way up to 11 on this all-new head-banging episode.
Rock on!
Welcome to Totally 80s and 90s Recall. On this podcast, we take a look at everything the memorable decades of the 80s and 90s had to offer, from music and movies to television and pop culture. We'll do this by providing our personal experiences and hopefully stir some rad memories, fun, and nostalgia along the way. If you're new to the show, we're so excited that you found us and promise you'll have an awesome time. And for our returning listeners and subscribers, it's great to have you back. I am one of your hosts, David, joined as always by a guy who definitely wanted to be a roadie for Motley Crue. My favorite metalhead, it is, of course, Rob.
Hey, your hair's looking good.
It does look good.
You got a little Chaz Michael vibe going on.
I like Chaz Michael Michaels.
It looks good.
I also had relations with Oksana Payul.
Oh, okay. Here we go. So this episode goes out to, it goes out to all of our young listeners that are trying to do your thing while all of the parental units just try to keep you down.
Keep you down.
When evening rolls around and it's time to hit the town, where do you go? You do the only thing you can do. You got to rock it. Am I right?
Am I right?
You've probably got the old folks saying, you need to end your date by 10. Stupid curfew. But if you're out on a date, we all know you don't bring them home late. It's practically a sin.
Practically.
Now, you know, there's no excuse, and you're probably feeling like you're going to lose and you never win. I remember this time my date and I pulled into a drive-in and we found a place to park. We hopped into a back seat where it's always nice and dark. We were just about to move, and I was thinking, Rob, this is a breeze. It was going really well.
I'm sure it was.
Yeah. When all of a sudden there was a light in my eye and a guy says, out of the car, long hair. Remember the day when we had long hair?
We have long hair right now.
I was rocking the long hair back then. He says, you're coming with me. Turns out it was the local police, Milwaukee's finest.
Milwaukee's finest.
Now, I'm going to go out on a limb and guess that your mother doesn't dance and your father isn't too hip on rock and roll. If that's the situation you find yourself in, we're here to let you know you're in the right place. So sit back and relax.
Sit back and relax. Right. That is a solid entrance to the show today. Solid rocking entrance to our show today. So, as usual, if anyone can figure that out, band and song title, you'll get one of our very exclusive and highly sought after Totally 80s 90s Recall stickers.
Oh,
those
yes.
Those are tough to get a hold of.
They are rare.
You're not finding those on eBay or anything like
nope.
that. No. So,
exclusive.
Before we jump in, I want to give a couple shout outs. We have a lot of other podcasts out there, 80s, 90s style, that support and, you know, help us out with our show. And, what is going on over there?
You're
having a good time?
You look good.
I look good.
You look real good.
And, well, we want to give a couple shout-outs to some of those that we like to listen to also and that we like to support. So we'll start with our friends Sean and Eric over at Generation Rewind. Also, Bad Movies Rule. That is a great podcast talking about different kinds of movies and whether or not they're actually good, actually bad. Lots of fun. The Mixtape Podcast, lots of fun over there. They do music. You'll get to hear lots of different types of music from the 80s and 90s, and they're branching out into the 2000s. And finally, Children of the 80s, new podcast, just about 10 episodes in, but husband and wife team out of Georgia, and they have lots of fun talking about growing up in the 80s.
Nice.
So check those out once you listen to Rob and I, if you still have that need for some more 80s and 90s nostalgia. With all that, Rob, what is the topic for our episode this week?
Yeah, so today we are talking about our favorite 80s, early 90s hair metal bands. Some might call them glam bands.
Glam
rock.
Yes.
Right. So yeah, 80s, 90s hair metal.
No ballads.
Ah, dang it.
Yes.
No ballads.
We're going with the rock versions of these songs today.
Yes.
Ballads will be another day.
Okay.
We'll have another episode where we cover just the softer side of
that was hard because there's some really good
ballads. There's some good ballads, but we'll get to those another time. So rock music in the 80s and early 90s took on a certain style. That style was referred to as hair bands, glam metal, whatever you wanted to call it. Pretty easy formula. Four or five dudes, lots of hairspray, and songs about girls, alcohol, drugs, and sex. Mm-hmm. And you had to throw in a ballad here or there, which we're not focusing on today. But that would hook the ladies in. And all the other dude rockers would like having the ladies around. Everyone was listening to some form of these bands, whether it was because you actually liked the band and the songs or because you liked the girls that liked the band and the songs. Hair metal ruled in the 80s and particularly the late 80s and very early 90s, as Rob alluded to now. But Rob, what types of bands do you consider in the hair band category? Because for me, Metallica, Guns N' Roses, Iron Maiden, Slayer, those were off limits. Those they have long hair, but they're not hair band glam metal to me. Those are just hard rock bands.
You want specific band names?
No, just what you generally.
I was really drawn to kind of the radio friendly rock. So I looked at things that I might have heard on the radio, or I might have owned myself, or because if we're talking 80s, I wasn't really that old.
Correct.
And then getting into the 90s, that became the grunge era for me. And so, so some of this rock was not stuff I listened to readily, but where I did listen to it was like, I clearly remember listening to it in high school in the weight room.
Room
I was playing on.
Good weight room songs.
Remember, I can't even remember there was a local rock station there in Portland. And they played more of the classic rock.
I forget which one that was.
Yeah, but
99 point something.
Something. So,
yeah, anyway. Forget that.
But yeah. So that's, I went with
I miss a good rock
more
station.
radio friendly. Stuff. Yeah.
Well, I've confessed previously, I did not listen to a lot of rock music until the late 80s. My first introduction to hair metal, if you want to call it that, was Def Leppard's Hysteria and Poison's Open Up and Say Ah.
Uh-huh.
Two great albums. I had heard other songs on the radio with Van Halen, Bon Jovi here and there, but once I got hooked on Def Leppard and Poison, it opened up all the Skid Rows, Warrants, Great Whites, and so on. Whether that's good or bad, it happened. In the early to mid 80s, all the hair bands didn't always get on the top 40, and you didn't always see them on MTV. The only time you could catch them a lot of times is on Headbangers Ball, which was on late at night because the parents didn't want to see it.
Right.
You remember Headbangers Ball around the
room? I do.
Yeah.
I do.
Hosted by
Ricky Rackman.
Ricky Rackman.
Yeah.
Yeah. Big rocker.
Yeah.
So,
little bald guy.
But in the late 80s, it all. Poison, Motley Crue, Def Leppard, all them, they started going mainstream. Hair metal became standard top 40. Like, those are top hits.
Right.
And their videos became prime time. No more Headbangers Ball only. Prime time, middle of the afternoon, so everybody can tune in and see what the boys and those hair bands were doing.
That's right. Yeah, it became kind of a cultural icon unto itself.
Oh,
just
yeah.
Just the hair
whole thing. The whole thing, the concerts. Like I said, at the opening band t-shirts, videos, and the videos had kind of some specific themes.
Yeah.
All of it.
And I also, as I was picking my music, I was thinking there's a right, wrong, or indifferent. There is a specific, audience to this music. There's a stereotypical
audience
that you think of. And so as I was selecting songs, I was thinking, would this particular person be listening to this song? And if I could imagine them in a T-top Camaro,
drinking some Miller High Life,
I was like, absolutely, that was my song.
So, that's it.
Yeah.
You mentioned how good my hair looked today.
Yeah,
it does look good.
It does look.
But I gotta tell you, those NASCAR glasses are getting the job done.
Yeah, I went with the kind of a damn Yankees type of. Was it Ted Nugent? Ted Nugent?
He was in that band. Yeah. Yes, he was. So. All right. Well, we're at the Dollhouse in Fort Lauderdale, rocking in Atlanta, Tattletale, and raising hell at the Seventh Veil. That's right. Strippers and hair bands go together like PB&J as we bow down before the altar of 80s rock. Well, real quick, fans, before we dive into these lists, I know you're waiting on the edge of your seats. If you want to ensure you never miss an episode of Totally 80s and 90s and Recall and haven't done so already, make sure you hit that subscribe button and then share it with a friend, which will help our show grow and spread the Rob and Dave experience. worldwide. Let's get this thing out to the masses. All right, Rob, it's time for some rock appreciation and theory. So take us to school and melt our faces with your number 10.
All right. Our number 10 is...
You're excited. I am jumping in. It's really good.
We haven't talked about our over and under.
Yeah, what do you think that's going to be?
I don't know.
Well, we listen to a lot of these same kind of songs. So there's definitely a chance for some crossover.
Right. And this is Slaughter. Up All Night.
You know, you can't spell laughter without slaughter.
Did you just come up with that? You heard that somewhere.
No, I just thought about it. I was looking at the word and I said, okay.
Wow, that's really good. Say that again. You can't spell laughter.
Cannot spell laughter without slaughter.
Oh, wow. Yeah, my hair is getting in the way of my headphones.
Hey, they did this in the 80s. We can manage it today.
How did they do that?
They did it.
Wow. Okay. Right. Well, hey, this is Up All Night by Slaughter, 1990. They're considered American glam band.
Yes.
Which the name to me would have indicated a harder sound. Harder sound. Yeah.
Yeah. They weren't that hard though.
No. Written by band members Mark Slaughter and Dana Strum. It was the third title on the band's debut album Stick It to Ya. The album names of some of these
they're really good.
So good. And the band's first single, their debut album, sold over 2 million copies worldwide and went double platinum, peaked at number 27 on the Billboard Hot 100. The music video was directed by Michael Bay.
It was placed
on New York Times list of the 15 essential hair metal videos.
There it goes.
Slaughter won the American Music Award for Favorite Heavy Metal Hard Rock New Artist in 1991. Wow. New artist in 91.
Wow.
I do not remember that.
Maybe they didn't have that category for that.
Beating out other popular hard rock and heavy metal acts of the time, Slaughter has continued to release new music and tour regularly. I think they had an album out in 2020. Yeah. They're still doing the state fair scene.
State fair scene. Gotta have it. Still getting paid though.
Right.
All right. Well, that's great. Number 10. Good start.
Okay.
Let's see. My number 10 is a group led by Sebastian. And no, Rob, not the kid from the Neverending Story. It is called Youth Gone Wild by Skid Row.
See, you know.
Right, here you go.
We are the youth gone wild.
Oh, that sounds exactly like it should, right?
Yeah,
there.
That's really good.
Exactly like it should.
Great voice.
Yes, released in 1989, only hit 99 in the U.S. Hot 100 and 27 on the mainstream rock charts. We've covered Skid Row in the past with their ballads, but this song rocks a little more, and I just couldn't have a list of hair metal without Skid Row. Not their highest charting song, but fun and memorable. It was the debut single from their debut album, and despite its lackluster position on the charts, it received heavy airplay on MTV. Perhaps, Rob, because of Sebastian's flowing blonde locks.
Oh.
It's got to be the hair, Cotton. It's beautiful.
It is beautiful. That blonde hair just flew in the wind.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well done.
Well done.
Well done, sound guys.
They're chiming in well today.
Hey.
Yeah.
All right. No, great song. So you said our over-under was what now?
I will go two.
You're going to go two?
I'm going two.
Two. Yeah. Okay.
What do you got? It's just a number.
I'm gonna go one.
Oh, okay.
I'm gonna go low. I think we're gonna be okay.
All right, we're gonna be all right.
All right, what do we got? My number nine?
Nine.
Oh, okay. So I'm gonna preface by my number nine could almost be an honorable mention.
Oh, okay.
Not a song I listened to. Actually, it came out in Came out in 83.
Oh, wow.
Good. So I was a young when this song comes on the radio,
you know it.
Or I heard it in the weight room, or it's a killer song and I like it.
Dio.
Nice. I love the lyrics.
Ride the tiger.
I like the way he sings.
Yeah.
Holy diva.
But
sounds early 80s.
The whole thing about the tiger stripes.
Tiger stripes.
Here, right here. Let's see if he does it. I love it.
Something is coming for you.
here is the tiger again. Oh no, no.
you don't have the tiger.
No, I think I missed it.
You missed it.
It reminds me of I could almost guess that like Jack Black.
Yes, Tenacious D.
That well, the greatest song ever.
Oh yeah, tribute.
Yeah. They were influenced by this song.
He likes Ronnie James Dio.
Yeah.
He was in the Pick of Destiny.
Yeah. So there you go. Anyway, so this is Holy Diver, Dio, 1983. It's their debut studio album by the American heavy band Dio. They're considered a heavy metal band.
Yeah, so that's I can see that.
Released 83, Ronnie James Dio, formerly of Black Sabbath. Him and the drummer broke away, made this band. The album was acclaimed by the music press and is the band's most successful effort. It only reached number 40 on the mainstream rock chart. Mm-hmm. It is one of Dio's most popular songs. It was banned after 9/11 by Clear Channel.
It's one of those.
Yeah. Rolling Stone.
Do you think it's the diving part?
I don't know.
Because of the way the planes went in?
I don't know.
So Holy Diver?
Maybe.
It's all I can think.
I don't know. In March 23, Rolling Stone ranked Holy Diver as the 9th greatest metal song of all time.
Oh, wow.
That's pretty intense.
That is.
Dio said the lyrics are about a Christ figure on another planet who sacrifices himself to redeem his people. When the people learn that he intends to leave them to save people on another planet, they selfishly ask him to stay. One asked Ronnie, what does Ronnie mean when he writes stuff like that? He exclaimed, what is it? A rabbi diving off a cliff? A rabbi with swimming trunks? Nobody's really sure. The music video, which is bizarro.
Nice.
Features Dio as a hairy barbarian adventuring through a desolate church. First, he strikes a shrouded figure and his hobgoblin friend with his sword. But instead of killing them, he turns them into rats. He later visits a blacksmith who is forging a sword. He throws his old sword away and deftly catches the newly forged one. Walking through a corridor, he encounters three seated hooded figures. As the camera pans across them, the third slowly raises its head and reveals eyes resembling those of a cat. The final shot shows Dio exiting the church.
It's a lot about Dio.
Yeah, it's crazy. Sadly, Ronnie James Dio died of stomach cancer at the age of 67 in 2010.
Rest in peace.
They've sold over 5 million records.
I wouldn't have had that as a hair metal song. I would have had it more of as like a metal hard rock song.
Yes, I agree. I was trying to think.
But there's no rule to that today.
My stereotypical listener.
Yes.
The guy that I imagine looking very similar to the gentleman sitting across from me.
I look good.
What would he be listening to?
Yeah, I gotcha.
I could see this song on a mixtape.
I didn't say it's wrong. I just said I wouldn't put it as a hairband.
No, that's good.
But that's okay. You might not like some of mine in the hairband category. Right. Well, your over-under was one, and we're hitting that one right here.
What?
So you can already figure out what it is.
Oh, no.
Number 9 reflects all I wanted to do when I was a kid, and that is, of course, Rob, stay up all night with Slaughter.
No way.
This is a great song.
I love
song.
His voice.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
That's right. It's it. It's the best part of the song if you really want to get into it. I think I get it right here. Here it is.
Everybody sing.
What's more rock and roll than staying up all night and sleeping all day? That's right.
Love it.
Well, notice I said when I was a kid I wanted to stay up, but now, Rob, at 47, I just want to get a good night's sleep. By the way,
You're an early riser. Though.
I am. By the way, when he shouts, everybody sing it now, that's quite the note he's able to hit. I couldn't do that. Released April 17th, 1990. I think you had what it hit. Yes, the Michael Bay part. I don't think you gave Michael Bay enough here. This video, I watched it. Check it out. We got fire, jerky camera work, lots of hair, wind and rain on the girls. But alas, Rob, no explosion. So I guess Michael was still learning his style because nothing blew up in the whole video.
Hadn't found his niche yet.
Hadn't found that niche yet. He didn't know he could just blow things up for fun at this point.
Yeah.
But yeah, young Michael Bay.
We had a previous episode where Michael Bay did a video.
He directed music videos in the 80s and early 90s.
Before
he became a famous director.
Yeah, he came up on another one.
Michael Bay. All right, so we've both been up all night.
All right, so that's
our over under ones. Ugh. That's one. We'll see if we get any further in this.
I think we might be
countdown. So
we might be higher.
All right, we're on to number 8 though.
All right, here's my number 8. You'll know it. There we go.
Who's not gonna know it?
The Scorpions.
It is the Scorpions. I like the Scorpions.
That's good.
So good. so good.
Yeah. So this is No One Like You by the Scorpions, 1982. German rock band, the Scorpions, reached number 65 on the Billboard Hot 100. It also attained the number one position on the U.S. Billboard Rock Tracks chart. Since the band's inception, its musical styles range from hard rock, heavy metal, and glam metal. Ooh. It's considered a glam metal band.
Oh, yes.
Scorpions are estimated to have sold over 100 million records around the world, making them one of the best-selling hard rock and heavy metal bands. One of their most recognized hits is Wind of Change. We've talked about that.
Yeah, I like that.
It remains one of the best-selling singles in the world of all time. Two of the songs on their ninth album, Love at First, Rock You Like a Hurricane, Still Loving You, are regarded as some of the most influential and popular rock works, both in heavy metal music and among rock ballads, defined as rock anthems and a true hymn of love. Scorpions are one of the best-selling bands in the history of music.
Nice.
Rolling Stones describes Scorpions as the heroes. This is a quote. Quote, heroes of heavy metal, and MTV called them, quote, ambassadors of rock. They have received prestigious awards such as three music World Music Awards, a star on the Hollywood Rock of Fame, a presence on the permanent exhibition of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Scorpions have been cited as a principal influence in the 1980s hard rock and heavy metal scenes, including artists such as Guns N' Roses, Motley Crue, Def Leppard, Metallica, Megadeth, Testament, Skid Row, Cinderella, and others.
You have a lot of... A lot of extra info today on these bands.
I thought I'm going to have more because here's why. I think what I found interesting about these researching these is they're very interconnected.
Okay.
And a lot of bands looked up to other bands and you can see the influence. And so I think the Scorpions deserve some time because they influenced a lot of the songs we're going to talk about later.
That is. Well, I don't have all that information. I just have... silly band stuff. So you definitely have quite the tutorials laid out for us.
The research on this one was probably the most fun I had doing research.
Most fun I had doing research. My hair is
you're having problems over there.
Into my glasses today. It's making it difficult. So well, that was a good number eight. I would have definitely had them as a hair band as well.
Yeah.
All right. Number eight for me is from a band with the all time party front man. It's Diamond Dave and the Boys with Panama.
I don't have any Van Halen on my list. But
I love this one.
I struggled.
It's so good.
I had a spot for it.
Great party song. Right here.
I like Van Halen.
When it breaks, right here.
Distinctive sound.
Oh, man. So
when
good.
You hear a Van Halen song, you know.
This is a good rocking song right here.
Love it.
Gotta love the Panama. This song is off Van Halen's highly successful 1984 album, another great video. My favorite kind of video, concert footage. David Lee Roth swinging on a string with a boombox, spandex, hair, everything you need. Oh, and great guitar riffs from Eddie on this song. Also, footage of Diamond Dave being arrested backstage. Girls and alcohol. What's more hair metal than that, Rob? Hit number 13 on the U.S. Hot 100, number 2 on the Billboard Mainstream Rock Charts. Also hit number 15 in Canada. The song actually is about a car Roth saw racing in Vegas called Panama Express.
Oh, wow.
Great fun rock song, style of music you definitely don't hear anymore.
I always wonder what that meant. I just figured it was Panama.
It is about a car.
The location.
My research led me to some car he saw running around the strip of Vegas.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Yeah, man. I love it. I love it. Yep, I had a spot, but I
took
pushed
it off.
Him out. Pushed
gotcha.
Him out. All right. My number seven?
Seven.
Well, our over and under.
We already hit it.
We're at your two. Yeah.
All right. Oh, you went to Skid Row as well?
I did.
Nice. I mean, we're going to have it.
So good.
We might go over two then today. I got a couple others I was worried you might have as well. But great minds think alike. Lots of rocking songs.
Yeah. Love it. So I don't know if there's anything new on here that I can say other than... It was their debut single from Skid Row, released in 89. Reached 99 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100. Oh, you did?
I did.
27 on the mainstream.
I said that.
You said that.
I did.
Skid Row was formed in 86 in New Jersey, so they were around a while. Yeah. So one of the members in Skid Row and Jon Bon Jovi were teenage friends. And actually, the guy from Skid Row was in Bon Jovi for a brief time before he was replaced by Richie Sambora. So they have a connection.
Gotcha.
Bon Jovi's manager, Doc McGee, sought out Skid Row and secured the band a record deal. Oh, because they were buddies. And one of the guy from they both agreed that if one of them made it to the music business, he would help the other one out.
That's good.
Yeah. And so they helped each other out. Skid Row recorded his debut album, Skid Row, at the Royal Recorders in Lake Geneva, Wisconsin, with producer Mike Wagner. Before releasing the album, the management paid a reported $35,000 to guitarist Gary Moore for the rights to the name of the namesake band. So there's somebody else already had the name Skid Row, and they had to go off and pay him. And,
yeah.
And get the...
you said, I don't have a lot more to add. And then you added a lot more.
Yeah. Love it. No, and I just love the interconnectedness. You know, Bon Jovi and Skid Row. Uh-huh. Like, they knew each other. They were running in the same circles. Love
it. They were running. All right. Yeah. Well, that takes me to my number seven.
Your number seven.
My number seven is a song that probably has not aged well, but very relevant to the time. And it is called 17 by Winger.
Yeah, this, yeah, cringy. There's a cringe factor in there.
Just a little. Here it comes. Good note, though. Lead singer Kip Winger.
Winger.
Yeah, fronted by beautiful lead singer, as I said, Kip Winger. Kip is quite a name. Song was released in 1989 and inspired by the Beatles song, I Saw Her Standing There. This hit number 26 on the US Billboard Hot 100 and number 19 on the US mainstream rock charts. The song is definitely cringy, as you said today, as Kip is referring to liking an underage girl. Even so, VH1 named it the 87th best hard rock song of all time. That's debatable. Now, these lyrics were so inspirational in the 80s, Rob. I'd like to do an artistic reading to really illustrate their importance. So, Rob, if you could hit that mute music that we prepared at the beginning.
Yep. You ready?
I'm ready. She said, I'm only 17. I'll show you love like you've never seen. She's only 17. Daddy says she's too young, but she's old enough for me. It's beautiful, Robert. Pure poetry.
Yeah, that makes it okay.
That makes it... What makes it okay?
That you said it in such a...
artistic style.
And you got a little Yo-Yo Ma in there. It makes it okay. It makes it better.
You kind of don't even think about the fact that he's going after an underage girl.
No, I forgot all about it.
Daddy did try to warn him, but Kip did not care.
No.
Old enough for me.
Wow.
That's
okay.
It.
Okay.
All right. So that takes you to your number six.
A little, what do you call that?
Exposition?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
Juxtaposition?
Really good. Really good.
All right. Number six.
All right. My number six is... Oh, I'm playing it from the beginning.
Oh, okay. Ah, yes. Classic.
This is Quiet Riot.
Yes, everybody knows the Quiet Riot. Great. You know, interestingly, that's a good song.
Yeah.
Go ahead and introduce that song.
Oh, okay. I'm going to say, originally it was a song by an English rock band called Slade.
Mm.
And I kind of got into a little rabbit hole of Slade.
Oh, some great.
Some of these older bands, some of these that newer bands, I'm going to call newer bands at the time.
Sure. Everybody wants to hear about Slade.
Yeah. Paid tribute to like bands like Slade. And I just found it very interesting. The song was originally released in 73. Sorry. In 83, they remade it. Quiet Riot remade it, which was a million-selling hit single in the United States, reaching number 5 on the Billboard Hot 100. British group Oasis covered the song. We know how much you like Oasis. And it was released as a B-side on their 1995 hit, Don't Look Back in Anger. Mm-hmm. And they regularly play it live. The Quiet Riot version went on to reach number 5 on the Billboard Hot 100. I said that. The song was certified gold in 2002. Quiet Riot's version of Come On Feel the Noise was ranked number 80 on VH1's 100 Greatest One-Hit Wonders. And in 2009, VH1 also ranked at number 41 on the best hard rock songs of all time.
Nice. Yeah. I actually like Metal Health better than...
Does that Bang Your Head?
Yeah.
Well, that's the...
It's traditionally called the Bang Your Head, but the name of it is Metal Health. I actually like that song a little better than the Come On Feel the Noise. Yep. And clever spelling with that title, right?
Yeah. Well, okay. I found when you play it, when I play it on like a streaming platform, Amazon Music, it says explicit next to it.
Oh, yeah.
But when I looked at the lyrics, I don't.
It might just be the title.
I don't see anything explicit. So I don't. Is it the title?
I think so.
I don't know. All right. Maybe I didn't look deep enough.
Well, that's good. So, Well, number six for me, good number six, Rob, comes from a band that decided that one T at the end of a rodent's name was not nearly enough. So they doubled it. And they gave us a great song called Round and Round. It is, of course, Rat. With two T's, Rob. Shoot an arrow.
Here it comes.
Oh, it's good. Another sound that sounds exactly like hair metal.
Yep.
All the rest of them. But it's great. I'll tell you why, Rob. I'll tell you why for sure. Great band name, by the way. Told you about the two T's. Originally, Rex. They were going to be called Crystal Pistol. Yuck. Good thing they stayed away from that. Then it was Mickey Rat, and finally just Rat.
Mickey so, Rat?
Well, that's the name of the dude, right? So, okay. Song released in 1984, climbing all the way to number 12 on the US Hot 100, number 4 on the mainstream rock charts. Rolling Stone ranked this number 20 on their 100 greatest heavy metal songs of all time. Valid. VH1 ranked it number 51 on its greatest songs of the 80s. That's interesting. And New York Times placed the music video on their list of 15 essential hair metal videos. Again, probably valid. So this is obviously a metal classic. I just love the chorus. Love will find a way, yep. Rob. Just give it time. Wiser words have never been spoken, Rob. Socrates, eat your heart out.
Socrates. Wow. Wild Stallion.
Wild Stallion.
Yeah. No, good song. Not on my list.
Oh, great.
So we're not going to.
Good news. No Iron Maiden on my list.
Oh.
Oh.
Nice. All right. Oh, no, Quiet Riot, you mean.
Or Quiet Riot. Yeah, and no Iron Maiden, too, since okay. we're talking about
no
both
Iron
of them.
Maiden on mine.
Yeah. There you go. I think a Quiet Riot, too, is more of a, I thought more of it like a metal than yep. a hair
yep.
band.
Yep, I agree. Gotcha. I agree, but like I said, I.
No, you're good.
This might also, well,
uh-huh.
nope, I'm all doing right. it.
Let's do it. Ah. You went deep into the 90s here.
I did.
92, 93?
Yeah, this was 91.
91?
91.
So yeah. good. Borderline ballad?
I.
Borderline.
Right? The borderline.
I think yep. so, but it's it might have enough heavy guitars. We'll say this is a rock, and Mama, I'm Coming Home's the ballad.
There you go. There yeah, you I go. Think it's fair.
I'll go that route.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah, so this is No More Tears, Ozzy Osbourne, 1991. With a running time of 7 minutes and 23 seconds, it is the longest solo song that Osbourne has ever recorded on a studio album. It reached number 71 on the Billboard Hot 100. Osbourne considers this song to be a, quote, a gift from God.
Wow.
In the 2002 remaster booklet for the No More Tears album, Osbourne stated the song was about a serial killer.
Nice.
I didn't get any deeper than that. I just thought that
I
was,
like it.
Quote, a successful song indebted to both glam metal
nice.
And prog rock, released the same year as Nirvana's Nevermind, and ranked it as the best song on the album with Mama, I'm Coming Home as a close second.
Good Those job. Are both good so, songs.
Yeah. So yeah, so a little, I just felt like, because I watched the documentary, The Dirt,
oh.
about Motley Crue, just to get a little feel. It is yeah. rough. Ooh,
it's interesting.
Yeah, yeah not a.
It's quite the reenactment.
Yeah. but they tour with, yeah.
Ozzy.
And so the influence that he had on the hair metal scene.
Yeah.
I think he needed to be on the list.
I saw the Behind the Music VH1 did on Ozzy and Motley Crue's tour. It was on the Motley Crue one. And Tommy Lee tells a story where Ozzy got drunk by the pool at the hotel they were staying
at. Yes.
And the pool staff or the hotel staff said he had to take Ozzy to his room to get him out of the pool because he's being obnoxious.
Uh-huh.
So Tommy Lee said he took him upstairs, took him in his room. He walked him in, then he turned around to close the door. Tommy said in the time he turned around to close the door and then turned back around, Ozzy was completely naked, and he had already spelled O-Z on the wall with his own feces.
Awesome.
Awesome. That's a rock and roll story.
I'm telling you.
Can't do any better than that.
What's the phrase? In almost every band that I researched, they use the word hedonistic.
Oh, yeah.
Hedonism.
Hedonistic.
Thank you. Sorry.
Hedonism.
Yeah. And every band.
Yes.
They're like,
that's good.
The life they led. Yeah.
My number five comes from a band probably most famous for being once bitten. It is Great Right.
Oh.
Great White with Rock Me.
Good one. Good one.
I like when his band tries to sing backup. I don't know if they're very good at it.
No.
But they're in there.
He's carrying it.
Oh, yeah. He can hit those notes, though.
That's the thing with a lot of these bands. They had, and their vocals were, they were good singers. Yeah, I mean, they could hit some notes that were pretty impressive.
Well, first of all, this video, I watched it, is on a stage like a concert, but no one's there. So maybe a sound check. I'm not sure. Also, it's indoors, but the lead singer's hair is flowing in the wind constantly, like entirely too much, especially when they're inside. This checks every glam metal box. Lots of hair, a blonde model dancing and firing a weapon towards the group. Sunglasses indoors. People are wet for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. Can't figure it out. Killer guitar riffs. This hit number 60 on the U.S. Hot 100, number 9 on the U.S. mainstream rock charts. Released in June of 87, it was a breakout hit. The original version was over 7 minutes long, but to get played on radio and MTV, they were told they had to cut it to 3 to 5 minutes. Apparently, they cut a lot of lyrics out because they kept the music track. However, after editing, I watched this and I listened to it. The song just ended up being 90% of them repeating, rock me, roll me through the night. They just echo that over and over.
It's good,
there's,
good song.
When they do the actual lyrics, there's only like 3 or 4 bars and they go right back into the chorus. So they like that chorus. It was working.
Yeah.
So that's it. Great white.
It worked for them.
Yes. So. I love them.
What are we at?
Number 4.
Not my number 4.
Ooh, it's going to be a good one.
Oh, it's a good
one. The way you said ooh.
Oh, yeah. This is a this is when we talk about this genre.
Genre.
This is a band that.
Oh, no.
Yeah. If they're not at the top.
Time to cross over. Yeah. Here we go. Oh, yeah. The Crew.
The Crew.
Nice. Can't have a countdown with no Crew.
No. I love it. It's such a good song.
Oh, it's
like
good.
Adrenaline, like, this is weight room, like.
Oh, yeah. You know. It's fantastic.
Treadmill.
All of it.
Yeah. So this is Motley Crue, 1987, off their fifth studio album, Girls, Girls, Girls.
Good album.
Motley Crue are regarded as one of the most influential metal bands of all time. Their sound was inspired by Decadence and Excess of Los Angeles.
Oh, yeah.
Peaked at number 8 on the Billboard Hot 100 in 87. It has been described as a staple of classic hard rock music, one of their most iconic tracks, one of the best hard rock songs of all time. Mm. Wild Side is an anthem of rebellion, a call to arms for teenagers and young adults. Let's see. There's a tribute band called Wild Side.
Ooh,
and it's
right.
A Motley Crue. Very clever.
Very clever.
The band wrote this as a tribute to their lives in Los Angeles and the hardships of the rock world as they experienced in the Sunset Strip. It was also a rally song for those who lived the life on the wild side. In his book, The Heroin Diaries, Nikki Sixx explained how the song came to be. He was casually seeing a Catholic schoolgirl. And one day asked her to recite the Lord's Prayer.
Oh.
He thought it sounded cool, so he messed with it, and out came Wildside.
Beautiful.
So much of the lyrics used religious imagery to flaunt the band's sins, and they are clearly not concerned with penance. One of the lines says, "Forward my mail to me in hell."
Nice.
The song goes on to give a perverse take on the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who ain't in heaven, be thy name on the Wildside.
So, nice.
A little trivia. In addition to being featured in movies like Friday Night Lights, Rockstar, Like a Father, Like Son, The Wrestler, and television shows like Brooklyn Nine-Nine, and The Office, this song was featured in what popular Netflix series starring Ralph Macchio?
Cobra Kai.
There you go.
Probably one whose Johnny was driving around in his hot rod.
That's right.
So. All right. Well, that's a good one. Get ready, Rob. Number 4, shoot you right through the heart. You know who to blame. This awesome song is, of course, You Give Love a Bad Name by
Bon Jovi.
Bon Jovi. If I can hit play, it won't let me hit play, Rob. You can sing it. How about that? How about now?
Oh. Yeah, you want Bon Jovi to do it. You want old John to do it. You don't want me to do it.
I just played this from the beginning because
it
starts out like very iconically.
Yep.
And I picked this Bon Jovi song for a specific reason. Everybody knows it. Kind of breaks down a little bit and then gets back into it. Can't mistake it for anything else. I like those guitars in the background. An angel smile indeed, Rob. Well, I picked this song because it's probably the first rock song, Bon Jovi rock song I ever heard. Most people go to Living on a Prayer or one of those, because those are, but for me, I just remember hearing this on the radio and being like, that's the first real loud rock song that I remember getting into. Mm-hmm. Z100 played Bon Jovi
all the time.
A lot. They played him all the time. So that's why I chose this, because it has that connection. This was off Slippery When Wet, released in 1986. We've previously discussed how great of an album title that is. This song hit number one. Come on, you knew that. Mm-hmm. U.S. Hot 100 was top 10 in 5 other countries. The opening of this song, great, memorable. The guitar kicking in is awesome. Cashbox, an American music trade magazine, called this, I know you like these terms, called this a jackhammer single, which is a very graphic description, in my opinion. Billboard called it hard rock, raspy, and aggressive. Well, I just remember waiting all day to hear it so I could swipe it off the radio, DJ intro and all. And yes, the Memorex blank tape did not let me down.
Memorex blank
tape. Yeah.
That was a mouthful, man.
So much.
Nice job.
It's not a mouthful like you.
Bon Jovi.
Yeah. Oh, I had to stall a little beginning of that. My computer crashed over here. And so I had nothing to read. So everything I was saying about Bon Jovi was off the top of my head.
Look at you.
Oof. All right. I'm willing to admit my mistakes.
That's all right.
All right. So number three.
We run a professional gig over here.
We do. I was waving to the producer to get in here.
Yeah.
Get me my connection back.
Didn't even know.
I had to do it myself.
We got a crack squad here.
We do.
It's good. Spared no expense. All right. My number three.
Your number three.
My number three. Oh, also somebody that if it didn't make the list in this conversation, I think
you should be fired.
We should be ashamed of ourselves. So
I got you.
It is.
Wow.
There's a lot of their songs that I could have picked.
You could have picked any song.
They have a pretty deep catalog of hair band or hair metal.
You did.
I like that one.
You could have picked any
photograph. No.
Any song.
I went with.
I'm just going to let you know real quick. This is my number three also.
Shut up.
I picked Armageddon because I didn't think you would go to it off the Def Leppard, because this is probably my third favorite song off there. But I did go to this one because I really do love it.
It's good.
It's great. So
and when I was making my list, I'd put
Def Leppard, and we've already used Pour Some Sugar on Me in a previous episode, so I didn't want to go back.
And actually, that's not my favorite. So, but I went between, I had a couple in the mix, and I'd pull one out, and I'd listen to it, and I always landed on this one. I like this one.
So, Armageddon, it also my number three.
Oh, that is so cool.
Yeah.
We're good.
We are good.
So this is English rock band Def Leppard, 87 album Hysteria. It was released as a single in 88.
Yes.
Went on to number three.
Yep.
In the United States. Became it was
number two in New Zealand.
I'll see you in your international.
Can't forget that. Yep. I need to rock out with New Zealand. They love great music.
Def Leppard's fourth album has been certified 12 times platinum.
Should be.
For the sales in the U.S. and 13 times platinum in Canada, selling over 25 million copies worldwide, making it one of the best-selling albums of all time. It's on all kinds of lists. The album spawned 6 top 20 U.S. singles, including the U.S. Billboard Hot 100, number one, Love Bites, Pour Some Sugar on Me, Hysteria, Armageddon, Animal, Rocket. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
As one of the world's best-selling music artists, Def Leppard have sold more than 100 million records worldwide and have two albums that have diamond certification.
Rob, my t-shirt today is Def Leppard's Hysteria. I love it. It's right there.
The band was ranked number 31 in VH1's 100 Greatest Artists of Hard Rock.
That is correct.
Number 70 in the 100 Greatest Artists of All Time.
Yep.
And Def Leppard were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2019.
So, awesome.
Yeah. If awesome they weren't song. On our list, we'd...
No, fired.
Yeah.
Well, awesome song. I don't have anything else than that.
Oh,
wow. And that summed it up.
So,
I think I had a better part that I singled out to really express that song.
Oh, yeah.
But I'll go with your chunk of music.
You should do it.
No, I'm done.
Oh, you sure?
Yeah, good.
All right.
So,
what's our?
You're on number two.
We were over. I know, but what's our over? We crossed over three
twice.
Okay.
We'll have to redo the numbers because we both had. Youth Gone Wild.
That's right. And Armageddon.
Armageddon. So we're at two.
Okay, we're two.
I said two.
All right. Well, we're
gonna, at two.
We're going to cross it.
You think so?
I know.
We haven't even given out the other songs yet.
Number two. Here we go.
Here's your number two.
My number two?
It. Yep. Is this You Love the Bag Man?
Yes, sir.
Again, so many Bon Jovi songs. How did we pick the same one?
I don't know. Also, I had some in, pulled them out. Okay. And I landed on this one.
Could have gone to any. I picked this because it's the first Bon Jovi song I ever heard. But
it's the one I think of.
You had plenty. Like Living on a Prayer?
I know.
Yeah.
I know.
All right. You got anything else besides what I said?
You said you almost had all the exact same notes.
Here we go.
It's about a woman who has jilted her lover. Okay.
Yeah.
Slippery When Wet. I purposely put in that because I wanted to hear you say Slippery When Wet.
Slippery When Wet.
Yep. Some other descriptions is somebody described it as bat out of hell infused with Aquanet.
Nice.
That was a really good descriptive.
That is it.
However, it was created for introducing the genre of hair metal to the mainstream.
Yep.
Right. So that's kind of what you said, you said. And it was placed on number 20 on VH1's list of the 100 best hard rock songs. So that's all I'm going to add to that one.
That's all you're going to add.
Yep.
All right. Well, my number two is one of the, comes from a band that could be argued embodied everything that was good, bad, and ugly about hair metal. It is, of course, a band you already mentioned, Motley Crue, but different song. Same old situation, parenthetical, S-O-S.
I don't know.
You know it.
Oh, yep, I do.
As soon as you hear it. I love this one. It's the same old situation. Had that video with the two blonde girls back there singing. They're in all leather. The one girl goes with her hand. That's really good. This just sounds like, it's just, this is hair metal. Here we go. I like the, come on.
That's a good one.
I'll always say this. Every Motley Crue song is a stripper song. I've said that before, but
it's true.
It's factual.
Yeah.
This song to me sounds like good intentions and questionable morals, Rob.
That's one of your stupid candles.
No, that's not what it is.
It's one of your stupid candles.
I'm just saying that. I think that when I hear it.
It's dumb.
God, can I just have some, existential thinking here?
No.
This is off the Dr. Feelgood album released in 1989.
I think your wig's too tight.
VH1 stated it's an all-time top 10 song about lesbianism. Not what I thought of first time I listened to it, but after looking at the lyrics, I think I do understand. Only hit number 78 on the U.S. Hot 100. Yep. And Vince Neil has also...
confirmed.
Backed that up. That's what the song's about.
Okay.
Only 78 on the US Hot 100. Not their most famous song off that album, but I've always thought it was fun and rock. The video's cool. It's got the classic concert footage. As I said, the two blonde bombshell backup singers. Tommy Lee's drum kit is going over the audience while he's playing.
That's cool.
That is. Starts out very 80s, Rob, as the band lands for the concert in a helicopter. All right. Can't get much more excess than that. And one of those balls, the plastic balls where they put a camera in it and then they throw it in the crowd.
Yeah.
So it's bouncing around and you get to see the crowd. And a lot of hot 80s ladies at Motley Crue concerts, by the way. Impossible trivia, Rob. I say impossible because you're not going to be able to answer it. Yeah. How many boob flashes do you think the crew got per concert average?
A lot.
A lot. Yeah. It's an impossible. We don't even know. That it could be an astronomical number.
And
so.
Yeah.
And that's just. I would say alone,
men or a woman.
Yeah, Vince on stage singing, just constant shirtless.
Some point he goes, oh, there's another one.
There's more boobs. I imagine at some point, if you're Motley Crue, you're like,
oh, boobs.
I can't believe a man would ever say this, but I've seen enough boobs.
Yeah. Can you just put those away, please?
Oh, that's wrong. Yeah. I can't believe that's a true thing.
Okay, not today.
Well.
Put them away.
We've gotten 10 through number 2, Rob. So we're going to head over to a little land we like to call...
the cut line.
Well, Rob, rocking out to 10 songs is not nearly enough for us this week. Not enough hair metal. So for this segment, we're each going to pick two more songs that just missed our top 10. We'll also identify one honorable mention that just rocked our brains off. And perhaps we've learned to appreciate even more as we've gotten older. So, Rob, keep this headbangers ball moving with your first cut.
All right, we are once again going to cross over.
Oh, my goodness.
I know.
We're not doing good today.
We
are too like-minded. We should have just got together and made a list, and then we would have had 20 different songs.
Oh, my gosh. Here it is.
Wow. No chance I thought you would have had this song. No chance. I was like, Rob's not going to put that song on it.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, my goodness. I thought there was no chance.
Yep. Yeah. Daddy says she's too young, but she's old enough for me. Oh,
my gosh. I read that. I did an artistic rendering.
Let's see. I have really nothing else to add.
Hold on, folks. That means he's got another two paragraphs. Let's go.
So
that's
true.
The kiss of death. Yeah. Nothing to add. Here we
go. Stop saying that. Yeah. So you talked about the Beatles reference. I saw her saying there. Uh-huh. But then in the quote, he's saying he took inspiration from the Beatles song. I saw her standing, blah, blah, blah. But then it ends. And that he wasn't aware that it was illegal for an adult to have sexual relations with a 17-year-old.
Kip wasn't aware?
That apparently Kip did not know.
Kip was aware. He's just giving a bad interview. He knew. Kip knows.
Let's see. In 1990, the band was nominated for an American. Again, 1990.
Yeah. You know, I can't seriously call a guy Kip. If I met him, I'd be like, I'm not calling you Kip. What's your actual name?
Fact that you've got a guy named Kip trying to convince you that he didn't know.
He was not birthed, and then the mom was like, oh, he looks like a Kip. No, I don't believe it. No one names their kid Kip.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm not, yeah. He has no credibility.
No.
Yeah, 1990.
Not calling you.
They were nominated for an American Music Award for Best New Heavy Metal Band.
Yeah, good for them.
It's crazy, 1990. Yeah. And then as the music scene changed with the popularity of grunge, they faded out. They disbanded in 94, but they recently, as of 2023, they released an album. So they're still out there banging away. So,
all right.
Yeah, 17.
17.
Yeah.
Good one. Well, my first cut comes from a band from the 70s who, in my opinion, were trying a little too hard here in the 80s. This might sound a little gross because the song is exactly what the title alludes to. It is Lick It Up, a Kiss.
Oh.
There you go, Rob.
I like this part right here.
Oh.
That's so good. Horrible video. That's just the worst.
Lick It Up?
It just does this most of the song. Yeah, Lick It Up. It's exactly what you think it is, Rob. Paul Stanley was not subtle in what you... The title is exactly what you would imagine it to be. This song was released September 22nd, 1983, hit number 6 on the US Hot 100. Top 10 hit, number 31 in the UK. For this song, the band took off their makeup, teased out their hair. That's why they're on this, because they had teased hair. All of them were wearing makeup. And they made a very cheesy 80s-inspired video, which it's not a good video. This is one of Kiss's most popular live songs, and they've played it over 1,500 times, making it one of the group's top 10 most played songs.
Wow.
You can probably figure out what the song's about, as we've discussed, but it has a very catchy chorus. You can lick it up all the time. I will say, Gene Simmons looks scary as hell in this video, and he should just keep the paint on his face because I don't like it.
They went sans paint?
Too aggressive. Like, oh, yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And they teased out the hair's real big. That's why I said they're trying too hard.
Uh-oh.
He's got eye makeup on. It's a whole thing. And not eye makeup like their paint, like eye makeup, like mascara and stuff.
Wow.
It proves the theory, though, Gene Simmons, no matter how scary he looked, that if you're a famous rock star, it looks don't matter. You get all the girls. Because he went out with Playboy centerfolds and all kinds of stuff. And he looks like a serial killer.
Yeah.
So he's tough.
Yeah.
Yeah. He would scare. If I woke up in the middle of the night and he was standing in my room, I would scream so loud. I would run for my life. He looks terrifying. So, all right, Rob.
All right.
A little Kiss. What's your second cut?
Oh, it's interesting. You went kind of a 70s.
Oh, no.
I went.
Are we crossing over again?
No.
Oh, okay.
We're not. Well, I got an explanation here a little bit. Okay. But so here we go.
All right. Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Again, I know. Wouldn't have hairbanded them.
I know.
But there were no specific rules to this.
I know.
80s rock.
I've got some notes that might
back you up a little bit.
I think so.
All right.
Yeah. This is a Judas Priest.
Yeah, I know.
You've got
I just don't think of Judas Priest as a hair metal.
No, I didn't either. Fine. I didn't either. And this is one of the songs as I was doing my research. So I had my playlist playing in the background, and then Amazon would kick on. So you might also like, and this came on. I thought, I'm going to add it to my list. Then I started reading about them. This is Judas Priest, 1982. They're a London band formed in 69. So they've been around a while. They have
Rob
sold over.
Halford?
Yep. They have sold over 50 million albums, frequently ranked as one of the greatest metal bands of all time. Halford's operatic vocal style and the twin guitar sound of Downing and Tipton have been a major influence on heavy metal bands.
Nice.
Judas Priest's image of leather spikes and other taboo articles of clothing were wildly influential during the glam metal era of the 1980s. So the album was described as the record that defines heavy metal. The song was described as one of the standards against which all metal tracks are measured. the band's signature tune. The band received a Grammy Award for Best Metal Performance in 2010, as recently as 2010. In 22, they were inducted to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. They're ranked fifth on their list of the 40 greatest metals. This song, VH1, put it on the list of 40, the fifth on the list of the 40 greatest metal songs. The song reached number 67 on the Billboard Hot 100, making it Judas Priest's only song to make it that far. Singer Rob Halford said the lyrics were about, quote, just this attitude that we've always had in Priest. And I dare say we've always had in our personal way of dealing with issues that are sent to challenge us. It also wrapped up the heavy metal community culture of the way we support each other with our metal. It is very much a song of hope and rising above the issues of difficulties that come your way. It's a song of resilience as well.
Nice.
And I just thought they are kind of forefathers to a lot of these bands that we've talked about.
Gotcha.
So they needed to be in the list. So.
Perfect. Well, my second cut's not a forefather, foremother, for anything. It's just a silly song. So, but a badass, a badass silly song. I'm just going to play it for him and see if you can figure it out.
Oh. Oh, this is, what's her name?
I definitely know.
shoot.
Hey, let's hold on for the chorus now. There it is.
First letter.
Well, let's go with this. That is Kiss Me Deadly by Lita Ford.
Ford!
There it is. I'm going to throw some love to female rockers in the 80s, too. The male bands get all the press and popularity, but there were a few like Lita out there rocking for sure. This song hit number 12 on the U.S. Hot 100, number 19 in Canada, number 21 in New Zealand. The song's video was placed on the New York Times list of 15 essential hair metal videos. It received some new popularity in 2019 after being in the movie Captain Marvel. Lita is actually English-born. I didn't know that.
Oh, I didn't know
And that. Was a member of the Runaways in the late 70s with Joan Jett. I know you like the Joan Jett. What's not to love here, Rob? She's singing about drinking beer, getting in fights, not getting laid. Very sorry to hear that, Lita. Hopefully that worked out for you in the end. great song. Good hair band song. And again, one for the ladies.
One for the ladies.
Yeah. All the dude bands get all the pub in the 80s, but there were a couple ladies running around singing some songs.
Trust me, I like the ladies.
I like the ladies. All these bands like the ladies.
All right.
All right. Honorable mention time.
Honorable mention. Okay.
All right.
We're going to have a conversation about this.
Oh.
I know.
Let's hope so.
You're not going to know them. You might. I shouldn't have said that.
No idea. Never heard of it. Doesn't sound like glam metal.
Band. No, and I'm going to... That's why it's in my honorable mention category.
All right.
Okay. That is a little band called Hanoi Rocks.
I've heard of that band.
Yes, and it's a song just called Tragedy.
Not familiar with their catalog.
No, I'm not either. But doing this show...
Forced you to be part of Hanoi
Rocks. I am now a fan. I've got a playlist going. They are really good. They are the first Finnish band to chart in the UK. They're a Finnish rock band founded in Helsinki. This is from their 1981 album called Bangkok Shocks, Saigon Shakes, Hanoi Rocks. Great title.
Yeah.
In the late 1984, the group was about to break into the US. Tragedy was released a little before the release. So this is kind of their early stuff.
Yeah.
The lyrics basically deal with a typical teen story of a first love and how one imagines it will last forever. At some point it all collapses. The result is tragedy and tears. Interesting.
And tears.
So they were from, so the folks there in the UK, in Finland or Stockholm or whatever, thought the bands, the way they dressed was so wild.
Okay.
That they were considered, that they were thought to be homosexual prostitutes because of their glam rock look.
That's something.
They were pictured on one of the six Finnish postage stamps in 2015. So the country celebrated them. The thing that I liked about this is there's a really great article from 2017, LA Weekly, this guy named Tim Summer.
Are you going to read the whole article?
He said, the title of it is that one band from Finland inspired the entire Sunset Strip hair metal scene.
Okay.
And he just goes on to talk about just how influential this band. And if you look at pictures of them,
yeah.
David Lee Roth stole his look from the lead singer of this band.
Yeah.
Poison looks The folks there on Sunset Strip took their looks from this band. This is where it started. And interestingly enough, the drummer for this band was the drummer that was killed driving with Vince Neil in 1984. Oh, and so Motley Crue went on to have an amazing career.
Of course.
And Hanoi Rocks ended up folding like within the year because they just could not make it back from the devastating
You're
loss
like
of their
a
drummer.
Whole behind the music on Hanoi Rocks today.
They're so good.
Oh,
they're so good.
There's something.
I got in this black hole. I was reading articles about them.
I'm going to tell you, I didn't love that song, but okay.
No. And their stuff sounded more like the Clash, or it was it was more that.
Yeah. I wasn't as into that,
but they were, their sound was different of the time and people, and that's what people were, that's what like Motley Crue modeled themselves after is these guys. These guys are the ones that started it. But anyway.
Well, I have nothing insightful about my honorable mention. I wrote here, which sounds really stupid after you read all that. Let's head to the drive-in, possibly the basement, and see what fun can happen, because I have Talk Dirty to Me by Poison.
This is your honorable mention?
Honorable mention.
Okay.
I love it.
Behind the Bushes.
Oh, yeah. Screaming for more. I'm screaming for more. Here it comes.
On the cellar door.
Lock that cellar door. I like the guitar.
He's going to some really
typical
conducive places. He's going behind a bush. He's going in the cellar.
Going to a cellar, yeah.
I mean, he couldn't find a nice soft place to land.
Rent a hotel room.
Had to go to a spider infested cellar and a pokey bushes.
Or nobody could find him down there.
All right.
Well, this song was released in 1987 off the Look What the Cat Dragged In album. It was the band's first top 40 hit in the U.S., peaking number 9 on the Hot 100, also hitting number 9 in Canada. It's my honorable mention because I didn't hear Poison until the Open Up and Say Ah album, which was released after this one. Once I heard Open Up and Say Ah, I went back, found this album, and ultimately this song, which I found to be really good. The chorus is a classic ode to teenage love. There was some drama that CeCe DeVille stole the song. Ooh. But a court ruled in favor of Poison in 2013. You can't have a hair metal countdown, Rob, without Poison. The hair, the makeup are legendary, and CeCe DeVille had one of the greatest quotes by a rock star ever, in my opinion. In VH1's Behind the Music, he stated when talking about his home, it was a house of whores, and then it became a house of horrors.
Oh, wow.
It's a great line, right?
About his own house? Yeah. About his own home?
Yeah.
Wow.
A house of whores turned into a house of horrors.
Right. Wow.
Cocaine is a hell of a drug.
Wow.
If my sound's still on, by the way, it also has one of the best moments of a singer ordering his guitar player to just do his job. So I don't know.
Did he say pick up your guitar and talk to me?
So okay. I'm just concerned with the amount of drugs CeCe was doing that Brett had real panic in his voice that if I don't tell and remind him, he'll miss the whole guitar riff. Do you think they're on stage at the concert and Brett's like, I better remind him because he's asleep over there or something. So he had to say. Also in Def Leppard's Armageddon It, Joe refers to Steve about playing the guitar riff.
Oh, yeah.
So something going on in the 80s where the guitarists are spacing out or I don't know what's going on around there.
Man.
So I think there's some real panic from some of these singers that they were going to miss their guitar riffs. Pick up your guitar and talk to me. You know, Joe Elliott says something about making, I think I have it right here. In fact, he says, Steve would have missed the guitar riff if Joe hadn't reminded him. He says, come on, Steve, hit it. So again, having to remind the guitarists, they must have been a bunch of dummies or something. I don't know what's going on
there. I don't know.
So I think it's drugs.
You think they did a little bit?
Yeah, maybe.
They seem real clean.
Yeah, they do. Yeah. Well, Rob, that takes you to your number one.
All right,
You haven't had any Poison on your countdown. So dare I say Poison becomes a number one song for you, because I don't know how you have a hairband album or a countdown and have no Poison, but you also have had a couple other choices. So we'll see what you come up with.
You're real good.
I think I'm astute.
Yeah. You are.
I think these things through.
You're a smart individual.
Gotcha.
And here we go.
Here we go. fantastic, right?
Yeah, I have.
Of course. You can't have it.
The ending part is the best. Oh, I can I can see the fireworks.
I like when he goes.
Yep, here it comes. That's the part I got. Here it comes.
Yeah, that's the best part. This is a great party song.
Yep. And then back into it.
Oh, yeah. Who's on drums?
Not CeCe.
No, CeCe's a guitarist. Ricky Rocket.
Ricky Rocket, that's right.
There he goes.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's my number one. My number one
It is called?
Nothing But a Good Time.
By Poison.
By Poison.
That is correct.
So yeah, so that, for me, when you talk hair metal, that's the band that opened it up to me. I went, oh, that's fun. Yeah. So this is their first single from the hard rock glam metal group Poison.
Yep.
Open Up and Say Ah. Was the name of the...
The album cover had that long tongue on like a demon.
Yes.
Yeah. Something.
Let's see. It solidified the group's status as hair metal's royalty. Top party band. Reached number 6 in the Billboard Hot 100.
Mm, it's been... top party band? I bet Motley Crue would throw their hat into the ring on that
true,
one.
True.
So
featured in, it's been in like Guitar Hero, NHL's Washington Capitals. They play it at every home victory.
Oh, yeah.
It's been on The Simpsons. It's been in movies like Zack and Mary Make a Porno, Balls of Fury, Grown Ups 2, Schitt's Creek, Young everything. Sheldon, Yogi. It's been in everything.
Love it.
Friday Night Lights, which is a great soundtrack, by the way.
Great.
In a 2018 interview with Axis, Poison drummer Ricky Rocket, there you go,
there
explained how the band wrote this for everyday people.
Yeah.
Quote, we wrote the song around the time we were living in a warehouse in downtown LA. We didn't have any money or our own at the time, but we would convince girls into getting fast food and taking us to the beach on the weekends.
Great plan.
We realized that song spoke to people who were just like us, people doing their best to grind it out. It was just like us when we were a band back in Pennsylvania. We all had second jobs so we could buy PA equipment or drum heads. Mm-hmm. That's what the song is for. It's for the working class and the wish that you can have a good time among all that.
Nice.
Music is the way to escape. At the end of the day, that's the payoff. And I thought that was a really great quote. And anyway,
great.
Great song.
It's a great song.
That's the song for me that...
That's it? That's your number
captures
one?
Captures hair metal for me.
Nice. Well, my number one... captures hair metal for me, and I think it's one of the quintessential hair metal songs of the time, and has absolutely nothing to do with dessert, unless your idea of dessert is way grosser than mine. I'm just gonna let you figure it out, Rob.
I don't think they're talking about pie.
Probably not, but it's a good euphemism or analogy, whatever word you want to use. Right here. Right here. In the video, he's got the big smile.
Well, yeah, and the eye, it's like early Black Hole Sun.
Yep. Swinging to drums, Rob.
Wow.
All right. Yep. This is like the apex to me of hair metal at the time. It's basically a parody of itself in some ways if you listen to it, but really good for that area, that era. The video has a lot of problems looking at it today. And it's kind of gross all around if I think about it as an adult. But through the lens of a 14-year-old, it was pretty awesome. Hit number 10 on the U.S. Hot 100, number 6 in Australia. Star Search cover model Bobby Brown makes another appearance on the countdown and later got married to the lead singer of Warrant, Janie Lane. It has been cited as a hair metal anthem. But I think when the slice of cherry pie lands perfectly in the girl's lap, perfect slice... the video officially went off the rails, and you could probably hear people saying that might just be about the end of hair glam metal. Personal opinion, of course. And Rob, that mood music I had earlier, I've prepared another little sonnet from the lyrics.
Oh boy.
So if you could cue up that music one more time, I want to do another artistic reading. Huh. Swinging in the living room, swinging in the kitchen. Most folks don't because they're too busy bitching. Swinging in there because she wanted me to feed her. So I mixed up the batter, Robin. She licked the beater. So.
What?
Just beautiful. All right?
No, it's not.
I see some tears in the studio.
The guys behind the booth are.
Just, yeah. It's, they standing wiped away ovation. A tear. Oh, it's perfect.
Yeah. Our sound guy, Kip.
I mixed up
our
the
sound guy, Kip. Sound guy, Kip.
I mixed up the batter. She licked the beater, Rob. You'll never forget that. It's fantastic.
I'm going to have to unpack that. I'm not really sure what he means.
I know. It's
deep.
A lot.
It's deep.
It's a lot.
Wow. So,
It was so good. Yo-Yo Ma had to stop playing.
Wow.
His cello. So that's good though. All right. Well, some other notable 80s, 90s hair metal songs. Pour Some Sugar on Me. Obviously, yep. We talked about that. I Want to Rock, Twisted Sister. Didn't hear that anywhere. Girls, Girls, Girls. I mean, you could name like 10 Motley Crue songs. Here I Go Again by Whitesnake. Living on a Prayer. A couple other we can name from Bon Jovi. Again, Metal Health from Quiet Riot. I saw some stuff from LA Guns.
Yeah.
I saw some stuff from, I did not like a lot of the, what was it? I forget the, I'm blanking on the band at the moment, but there are some other that I listened to. They definitely were trying to copy everybody else.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Like that's all they were trying to do. And it wasn't as good as the other ones.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I found some kind of obscure ones that I kind
of course
I vaguely remember, but, there's a band called Kicks. With two X's.
Yeah. Trickster.
Yeah, yeah. Rock You Like a Hurricane, we mentioned that.
Oh, yeah.
Unskinny Bop, that was later.
And
was that later?
That was early 90s.
Early
90s,
yeah.
A good one.
Smoking in the Boys'
Unskinny
Room.
Unskinny Bop was also mentioned on our 90s rock
yes,
episode.
Yes, it was. Yeah. So. I almost had some Kiss in there.
Oh, okay.
I almost had some Alice Cooper.
Ooh, Alice Cooper, yeah.
His song Poison.
Again, I don't think that's hair metal, but
I know.
It's between everyone to decide.
Lover Boy, Working for the Weekend?
To me, that's just a blue-collar rock song.
Oh, yeah, that came up on a list for me, and I was like, I don't.
Europe, Final Countdown.
Ooh, I loved that song.
Yeah, that could have been one.
I remember when that one came up.
So.
I considered it a ballad, though. It's got kind of a, it's maybe. Slower.
All right.
Anyway.
Well, lots of good ones, but I think we put together a pretty kick-ass rock playlist, yeah. Rob, yeah. And anything, anyone in any Camaro could appreciate and love. So, well, if you
one might say that we put together a Motley Crue
of songs. Your segues are beautiful, Rob. You should have played the Yo-Yo Ma while you were saying
I've been holding on to that.
Yeah. If you enjoy this podcast, please take a second to give it 5 stars and drop us a review. Also, check out our website at totally80s90srecall.podbean.com, where you can find links to all of our social media sites and subscribe to our Facebook group for weekly updates and future episode ideas. If you want to get in touch with us, which we would love you to do, email the show at 80s90srecall@gmail.com, which allows you to recommend future show ideas, comment on previous topics, and ask us questions, which we'll feature on future mailbag episodes. Finally, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and you should definitely subscribe for this one. If there's one you're going to watch, this is the one, because we look good today. That's right. So, go on over to YouTube and check us out. Links to all of our social media, merchandise store, and email are included in the show notes, so be sure to check those out after this episode.
So, what are we doing next time? What's our homework?
Well, before we do the homework, I usually close the show out. I was going to ask you if you had any closing thoughts.
No, I don't.
I'm very excited about the homework.
Yeah, I know. I want to know what we do next time. I really enjoyed the research.
Yes, you did.
It was so good.
You told me about the research.
Yeah, and I thought that
we heard the research. it was almost like taking a 101 in college on hair metal appreciation.
Well, I hope
Professor
that the
McCracken.
Listeners in their car right now, or they're on their treadmill, or they're doing whatever. That they walked away going, I learned something.
Learned
new.
Something.
And I'm going to go Google that band. I'm going to go Google Hanoi Rocks
Hanoi
and just
Rocks.
Check it out. Check them out.
Or they learned that I mixed up the batter and she licked the beater. They might have learned that too, Rob. You never know.
They might have.
Well, sadly, that brings us to the end of this episode. We hope you enjoyed banging your head, listening to our favorite hair band songs of the 1980s. And a couple in the early 90s. If you like today's musical choices, which you should, we have provided links to Spotify, Apple, and Amazon playlists in the show notes so you can go over and headbang to these great songs yourself. Finally, we'd like to thank all our listeners, whether first-timers or subscribers, for hanging out with Rob and I. Hopefully, we gave you an hour or so of some laughs. And don't forget to tune in for all new episodes of Totally 80s and 90s Recall every Tuesday. And Rob, even though you asked early, I'm going to give it to you now.
All right.
Homework for the next one.
Yeah.
We're going to be covering the 1993 movie, classic, Dazed and Confused. It is going to be All Right, All Right, All Right.
Oh.
So you won't want to miss that, Rob.
Well played.
Well played.
That was good. Yeah. That'll be fun.
It will be fun.
Have not seen that movie in a while, so I'm going to have to
more great rock music.
Revisit it.
Yeah. More great rock music.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Also, great soundtrack.
Not hair metal, but great rock music.
Great soundtrack.
So, well, you got anything else?
I do not.
Fancy Goodbye?
No fancy goodbye.
No fancy goodbye.
I thought maybe I might have one. Not this time. No fancy goodbye.
All right.
All right. Peace out.
Peace out. I thought you might play the Yo-Yo Ma one more time for the closeout.
I think we've... We've done it enough.
Of this, my artistic greetings.
That's a lot of hair. And it's hot.
It's hot.
Hot. You look good.
Lick the beater, Rob.
You make that wig look good.
Dude, lick the beater.